Hi everyone, Christina here. Welcome to another live video. Let me turn off the sound here. I'm hoping everything is coming through. Let me check my, it's giving me an ad. Sorry guys. I'm assuming it's coming through okay. I'm seeing your comments come through, so hopefully it's not a repeat of last week's kind of craziness. So hold on, let's see here. Looks like it's coming through. Yay, good job. Okay. All right, thank you all for joining me today in my new little temporary setup. It doesn't look really temporary because I have a lot of the stuff from my previous craft room that could just go on top of the tabletops back here. But really, let's see, maybe you guys can see, I just have like some folding tables back into the corner, and I've got my lovely window here. The window's open. It is nearly 60 degrees Fahrenheit here. It's beautiful and sunny. I wish I was outside, but I'm also here with you, so I'm happy to be here. So, okay, let's get into the crafting. We're gonna do some, well, I'm not entirely sure, because most of my time that I would have used to prep for this live was used setting all this up in the background and trying to get my supplies back in like within arm's reach, because I thought I did a good job packing things, like labeling it like tabletop, like stuff I need. Apparently I didn't. So anyway, for those of you who weren't aware, I moved to a new home probably, oh gosh, almost a month ago, nearly a month ago, maybe 3.5 weeks. And I have a temporary craft room set up in a bedroom. Hopefully my actual craft room will start under construction in the next week or so, but with COVID things are just slower these days, and I don't think I'm really going to be in my actual craft room until May. So yeah, anyway, so let's go to the overhead. I'm gonna not be in the top corner because I'm probably going to be running around trying to find things in here. So best not to do that. I also have my glass of water here, courtesy of the husband. Thank you. He might be watching. I have no idea. Thank you for the water, honey. Okay, so I thought I would use these two products that from Simon. They came out a while ago and I didn't have a chance to use them, and I really wanted to try them out. So I thought I would do some Karin marker watercoloring on this one, and then just do a simple die cut on top, and we can just have fun and talk while I make this. Stephanie's like, a lot of people will envy you for your temp. Are you talking about the temperature outside or my temporary craft room? Either way, I feel pretty lucky. So, all right, so this is actually Heart Garden. Oh, sorry, that is super bright. What is going on here? You know what? Maybe you need to turn this light off. Hold on. Now it's real dark. Well, gosh. Okay, hold on. I'm figuring out my lighting here, everyone. Hold on. Let's see if we can get this to brighten up a little. I'm trying to figure out a good setup for all this. And it's hard with my window here, you know? Like in my old craft room, I had blinds that I would just close and it would completely control the light situation. So this is all new for me. I do like the natural lighting, but hopefully it doesn't make it too hard for you guys to, you know, see what's going on. Anyway, this is Heart Garden. That's what the stamp set is. And here we go. So there are a couple options. I was thinking of doing a wash of color and then stamp this on top. Or I was thinking of stamping it first and just coloring the hearts and flowers. It could go either way. Hello, everyone's from all over the place. Thank you for joining today. Okay, I'm kind of liking the idea of the color and then stamping on top. So I think I'm going to do that. And you know what? I kind of do think I need this extra light right here. Hold on. just a fill light. It's gonna be super bright for a minute, sorry guys. There we go. Okay, yeah, I think I did need that extra light. Here we are, starting over. Okay, so maybe we'll do a couple different color combinations. I'm gonna be using some Artistico extra white watercolor paper. This is the cold press version. Since we're gonna do two, I'm going to take off two sheets. If you wanted to watercolor while still on the block, you definitely could. I like to remove it just because it's a little bit easier. Okay. Thankfully, I have two. Well, we can actually put these all on one board. Let's put them on one board. You take both of these down using some painter's tape. And since I'm just sitting here, hello, you're in the top corner. We're gonna do two really simple washes of watercolor and then stamp on top. That is the plan. And I'm taping these down because watercolor paper will warp when you add water to it. Let's see, is that the right side? I'm gonna put these semi-close so I can have them share the same tape. In fact, that's too close. There we go. Are all of you guys in the United States, how is your weather? Is it starting to warm up? Ours is starting to warm up and I could not be happier. I might go buy a bike today. What? Who is this? Who is she? We don't know her. I was trying to figure out the last time I've ridden a bike. And I'm not that concerned because you know what they say. Like, it's like riding a bike, like getting run on a bike. So I'm not that concerned. But, yeah. Anyway, so for those of you who are not like current bike riders, like actual bike outside on the road in public, when's the last time you rode a bike? Or ever? Some people just, you know, haven't ever had the opportunity. Okay, people are saying windy and rainy. It's in the 40s. That sounds warm. It was warm for a couple days, but it's chilly again. I'm in Florida, 75 today. Now you're just rubbing it in. Those of us who have been in the dead of winter, we're like, anything above 40. And isn't it funny that, like, you know, as the temperatures are dropping in the fall, like 55 degrees is frigid. You can't even be outside anymore. But then after winter and you're coming out of the cold, 55 degrees feels tropical. You might as well be on a beach. Isn't it funny how that works here? All right, people are saying, I haven't rode a bike in years, used to ride all the time. Vicky says she rode a bike 2 years ago and it was hilarious. Yeah. 11 years old was the last time that Belle Rose rode her bike. Yeah. All right, I've gotta take myself off screen so I can go grab some markers. And I actually have a bunch I need to put away. All right, so here's my Karin brush marker box. I'm gonna stand up while I craft. I ended up putting my folding table that I'm working on bed risers. So it's not quite as tall as my old work surface. It's about the countertop height, but I'm pretty tall. I'm like 5'9 and a half, almost 5'10. So I like my counters really high. Okay, here is my Karin Brushmarker Pro box. I made this swatch chart a while ago, and a lot of people asked about it, and I know you can make it on your own, but I'm wondering, Would you guys be interested in seeing another live where I walk you through how to make your own chart like this? There would be a download involved, things like that. Thinking maybe next week, like a special one at night. And we would just recreate a swatch chart like this using all our colors. Or if you don't have all the colors, you could do just the ones you have. So let me know. Would you want to do something like this? I'm thinking maybe like Tuesday or Wednesday night. I'm not sure. Maybe I'll do a poll or something. But okay, some people are saying yes. Okay. All right. Well, the thing that I like about this, I like about this chart, is that as I put my markers away, I can put it back in the right spot, and then they're always like correct according to the chart. So 276. This one I'm guessing is right here. And some of these, when they're like two in a row, I'm like, oh crap, which one was it? Okay, so that's 281. So that makes this one right there, this one right there, and right there. Perfect. All right, that makes it super easy. Yes, you could do a swatch chart with other types of markers. I think Tombows would work great for this, or even if you want to do regular watercolors. Sorry if you guys hear stuff from outside my window. It's a little toasty in my little craft room here, so I'm improvising. Okay. And you know what? I also need to go get water. Many of you guys missed it from my live last week. This is the water bucket that I use. It has three big, huge wells. In fact, I always fill all three, but I rarely get to this one. I usually just use these two. Anyway, I'll be right back. Talk amongst yourselves. Okay, back with water. I'll just put this over here. Okay, so I'm thinking maybe we'll do one with like spring colors, since it is, you know, like flower type images, you know, with the little hearts on stems. So maybe like spring type colors, pinks, yellows, maybe into purple. And then over here we'll do full on rainbow. And since the stamp is more landscape, we'll turn it this way. All right, so doing kind of gradient color shifts with markers is actually not that different. Let me get on my chair here. From working with regular watercolors. So let's pick out some colors. All right, sorry, that's real bright. Let's pick out some colors. Let's go with bright pink. And we're gonna go to a bright golden yellow. And then maybe we'll do, let's see, I think 197 would be good. We're going springtime color, so maybe we'll do a bright green. I kind of am thinking this 210 right down here would be good. So, 210. Okay. We'll do those little springtime colors up there. And for the bottom one, we're going to do more rainbow-ish, right? So, we're going to start with magenta. And then I think we can skip orange because we can, like, get the magenta with the yellow. Right, so we'll go to that one. I do think I want a bright green though. This one looks like a nice bright grass green, right? I love that one. So 253, nice bright yellow green. We'll go to, let's see, do we want to go a teal or a blue? Well, this one could go both ways. See that color? Isn't that nice? It's a nice color. 207. It's called Cyan. Perfect. And then we'll end with a purple. And I kind of want it to be more of a violet, like a bluish purple. So we'll do this one, 688. Oh, and it's even called violet blue. Perfect. All right, so those are our two color palettes. This one is a little bit rainbowy, but, you know, not quite. All right, put those away, set them aside. And set those aside, and we'll start with this top one up here. I like to use a somewhat larger brush for stuff like this. I think I'm going to use this half-inch flat brush. I think that'll work well. And I'm also going to get a paper towel handy. Okay. For those just joining, we're going to be doing some sort of gradient backgrounds using Karin markers. Okay, so I'm going to start with the purple, and I'm just going to start. There we go. I'm going to try this method where I put all the colors on first. Might have to do a second layer to get them as intense as I want. But I love how easy these reactivate with water. All right, and then down to this green. All right, here we go. We can actually zoom in a little bit too. These are Karin markers, for those that are wondering. All right, you can just see how that starts to soften up. Bring it down into the pink. The pink's really settling into the paper. I might have to go over again with more color. Sometimes if it settles into the paper for a little bit too long, like there's a little too much time between when you put it on the paper and when you actually wet it, sometimes it doesn't want to move around. I think that's what's happened up here, where you can see the edges of the marker. So this is a good teaching moment. It's important to realize the time between when you apply it and when you actually get it wet. We're going to try it differently down here. Let's let that dry, and we'll do this top one a little bit differently. This is a good opportunity to try something different, right? All right, let me put those colors aside. We'll go over it with another layer here in a bit. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the color out. And before I really start doing much, I'm going to come in here and start softening it. And let's see if that makes a difference. I think it did soften it a little bit more. But also, I haven't really used these Karin markers in huge spaces like this. You know, like most of the time I use it in just like smaller little spaces. So maybe we'll have to do a little bit of experimenting with that as well. All right, we really want these to overlap because we want to get some orange. I don't know if it'll work, but we're going to try. I think the yellow definitely blended better this time around. I'm just pulling it up to the top here. All right, let's go to green. These are dye-based markers, I believe. A little bit of green. I'm realizing that if I want to get to purple, I've got to slow my roll. Alright. I don't want to lose the yellow, so I'm going to try to tell myself stop moving up so much. Okay, we've got the cyan color. You know, I don't really like, or not like, I don't really not like, kind of like this like horizontal stripey texture we're getting. I think it looks really neat. All right, I'm gonna end with the purple. And I can take this purple up to the top a little bit. Or up into the blue, I mean. Oh yeah, that's a great purple. Okay. I'm gonna zoom out so you can see both of these. And just a little bit of a different technique. You can still see, I mean, you can still see the marker strokes, right? But it's not as pronounced down here as it is up here. Stephanie has a good question. She's asking, when you were doing large areas like this, why do you even consider using pens rather than regular watercolor? Mostly because of the color. Karin markers and also like liquid watercolor or any of the really dye-based water mediums tend to have more of a brightness to them. So I really like to use those for that reason. You don't have to, but you can. You know what? I just realized my heat tool is completely down on the floor and I can't reach it. Come over here, heat tool. It was one of the last things I plugged in when I was setting up my desk. Okay. Here we are. Here's a heat tool. I'm gonna heat set these until they're dry. Okay, while I was drying that, I saw a few comments about, can you pick it up from a palette? You can. In fact, let's see, do I know where my palette is? If I know where my palette is and I can find it, let's try that for a second coat on the top one. And I closed my window because it was getting loud out there. Okay, let's see here. Pretty sure I will find that palette. You know what? I already know where it's at. What am I doing? Found it. Looks like I haven't washed it since the last time I used it. Look at that. Getting a little bright. Okay. Oh, I don't know what happened there. What did I set down? I don't even know. Okay. We're gonna go back to those original marker colors. These. And we're gonna scribble a bunch on a slick surface. And then pick it up with our brush. We are just experimenting today, seeing what happens. Okay, get a nice purple color going here. I don't think I had enough color on my brush. Go straight into the pink. Yeah, I think this might be better for such a large area to go straight to the paper. because you just can't gauge how much ink you're gonna need, you know? Yeah, that's hard. All right. We'll come back to that. I kind of like how this one turned out here at the bottom. I think it looks great. So it's just this one up here that I'm struggling loving, you know? Sometimes you just struggle loving what you're working on. It is a human reaction. Okay. So I think what we learned from these is the best way to go about doing a multicolor gradient with markers on a large area is to do one color at a time and apply it directly to the paper. I think we could dry this and try it one more time, that same method, and we might get a little better blend and less streaks. So let's try that. I'm not ready to give up on it. Are you guys? I'm not ready to give up on it. Okay, here we go. Let's try the method that we used down here. We'll try it up here. We're gonna start with bringing my water bucket over so that I can have quick access to the water. All right. Quickly come in with my brush. To the pink. Quickly coming to the water. You know what? I don't know that it's completely hiding the original streakiness, but it's not making it worse. I like how it's going more now, though. That's for sure. All right. Grab this gold. My marker feels like it's a little dry. Or maybe I'm just working too quickly. That gold color is definitely gold, not yellow. All right, and then we're gonna finish with this green color. If anything, today was good for trying out a couple different methods. Okay, it's kind of a dirty mix of color now, but you know what? Once we stamp on top, probably won't show as much. I'm just putting the lids back on my markers. Moving my water bucket out of the way. And I'll hit this with my heat tool till it's dry. Okay. Oh, not quite dry. Now we're dry. All right, let's remove these from the board. I kind of like the streaks now. I was skeptical, but I kind of like them. I don't know if you guys can see, there's this little water droplet that got up here. These markers are very similar to distress inks in the way that they react with water once the color is already dry. It will pull up the color, almost like a bleaching effect, and it can look really, really cool. So we might do some of that after we are finished with our stamping. All right, so here are our two backgrounds. Yes, cherry colors. And the yellow, I think Lisa's right. She says that the yellow gold looks much better dry. I would have to agree. It's just a different look. All right, so I'm gonna get my MISTI so that we can do some stamping. Set these aside for a minute and get out my MISTI. Zoom out a little. Sorry, I've got my light up here. I was hoping to get my light off to the side enough that that wouldn't be an issue, but I guess I didn't get it quite far enough. All right, here's the stamp we're using. This is Heart Garden. My MISTI is backwards. There we go. No wonder it looks so funny to me. All right, we need to take out the insert since it's a cling stamp. And we just need to decide if we want it just like this. I think that'll be perfect. Okay. Going to be using Versamark ink, and I'm going to hit this with an anti-static powder tool before I get going, because I'm going to emboss this in white. I think it'll look really striking against the very bright colors. Barbara says they're kind of Jolly Rancher colors. That's kind of true. Okay, so I'm using Versamark. And I'm actually going to stamp this twice, I think, because it is on textured watercolor paper. All right, I'm using a new, more flat Stampin Bug from my friend Robin. She just sent it. Look how cute. And it's got rainbows on one side and then glitter on the other. I'll link to the original Stampin Bug that she made me. I'll link to that once I'm done here. And the video is no longer live, so you guys can find her shop on Etsy. Or sometimes Robin tunes in. So Robin, if you're tuned in, go ahead and send everyone to your Etsy shop. Krista's asking if this is one of my stamp designs. And no, it's not. I believe this is from Sherry Carroll. All right. I'm gonna go ahead and heat emboss this, and then we'll move on to the other one. Getting embossing powder everywhere. With such a large image, it's hard. I'm gonna love this so much. Okay, for little areas where, I don't know if you can see this, I've got like embossing powder in areas where I don't want it. Let's see, over a trash can, that helps. I also missed powder right there. Or I probably missed inking it. All right, I want to make sure I get as much powder off. It airs where I don't want it. And this is just a reminder to myself to use that anti-sag powder tool even more liberally on the other one. Okay, I think that's pretty good. I'm gonna have to clean up that powder before I stamp again. Cute is that? I love that image. I've got a couple spots that didn't quite melt. I've got to hit them again. Okay. I'm gonna grab baby wipe and try to clean up this powder that fell in this bottom corner. Serves me right for using embossing powder over the top of my MISTI. Gonna make sure this is completely dry before I put my project inside. All right, here we go. We can put this in that top corner again, and I'm going to be even more generous with the powder tool this time, especially in the area that I want up top. No stray embossing powder. My stamp is still on the door of my MISTI. Let's see, make sure that's in the top corner. Oh, Julie's talking about Jolly Ranchers, how they're a very hard candy and usually don't chew them. Aren't there chewable Jolly Ranchers out there? I swear I saw something like that. Funny story about Jolly Ranchers. When I was in fourth grade, I had a teacher, Mr. Phipps, who had this weird Jolly Rancher thing. He would take Taco Bell hot sauce and just put enough just right on top of the Jolly Rancher and then eat it. And he would... It was sort of like a little dare that he dared the students to try it. It was actually really good, like the spicy with the sweet. Okay. Time for embossing. I'm learning my lesson. I'm moving this away. And then I can come in with my embossing powder. Oh, I love this so much. That rainbow color is just gorgeous. I'm also going to tap this off over a trash can because it's just such a large area, you know? All of my extra powder tool worked. Looks great. Love how those look. They turned out so awesome. Gotta clean up some powder that went everywhere. All right, and then I'm gonna work on putting all this together and pick a greeting and all that. All right, so put those paper towels away. I was thinking for the greeting, I could do this just because, and it would fit kind of down in the bottom corner on each. I think that could be really pretty. In fact, I'm sort of hoping I can make these into 5x7 cards. Let's see if that is even possible. I have my waffle flower A7 layer size. And let's see. I could probably do that. And I would get most of all the image. I like that. All right, let's do some die cutting. I haven't die cut in like a month. It's crazy. Thankfully, my die cutting machine is all set up. It's not too far across the room. Alrighty. Just need to get those in the right spots. Perfect. I love that. All right. Then I can just move these to the other one. You guys talking about the little heart that's off the side? Yeah, I think I'm going to fix that with a white gel pen. Okay. Tape that down. Right there, my die cutting machine. Love it even more now. Okay, so for the greeting, I'm thinking like a holographic paper would look awesome, especially with like this like rainbow thing I've got going here. So let me see if I can find where my holographic paper is. That might be the real feat for today. Because I'm thinking, let's see, just holographic, like kind of popped up, would look really, really cool on that. Maybe with like a white. Well, I don't know. I wonder if I could just cut that out and pop that up off the top. That might look really cool. Let's cut this first and see what the holographic looks like. We might not have to do that. Okay. If I were holographic paper, where would I hide? Found it! Okay. I even found some that doesn't, you know, it has a chunk taken out of already. Alrighty. Okay. I'm using my metal shim for this next part for die cutting, since I already know that holographic paper is kind of thick. I hope this cut looks like it's gonna be perfect. All right. Make sure I keep that little dot for the eye. All right, let's see this. Yeah, I think it would benefit from having a white background. I think it would for sure. Kind of don't want to layer it up too much, so I'm just going to cut the shadow out of white, and then that should do it. Hold on, let me grab some white cardstock here. I also need to cut another holographic one, so I'll cut both of these at the same time. Something to just set it off from the very colorful background. All right, and we just need one more white. So I'll run that through. This one up. The Heart Garden stamp is from Simon. Just saw someone in the comments ask that. Okay, I'm gonna grab two card bases. Okay. Oh, someone was saying vellum. I don't know that vellum would have enough. I mean, I guess I could layer vellum, but I don't know that vellum would have enough contrast, you know? I think putting it on white is gonna be perfect. Oh yeah, I love that. It would even look great on black, right? Or if I wanted to be even more extra, I would cut this out of the watercolor paper, put a foam adhesive behind the watercolor paper on the card, and then stack a bunch of die cuts and have the top one be the hollow one. I don't know that I'm that ambitious today. So we're doing it this way. All right, tweezers and glue. I'm using precision tip glue from Honey Bee. And we can zoom in here for all this detail work. I'm just doing little dots of glue. And directly onto the shadow die. Lovely. Put a little dab of glue right there. And I can pick up this little guy and put him right on top. There we go. All right, now just to do that all over again. Just little dabs of glue. If you ever have too much glue go down, it kind of blobs or something like that, you can always dab your die cut on a piece of scratch paper, and that just takes off some of the excess glue. That's a great technique when you have really dainty die cuts. Glue up there. Grab this little guy. There he goes. Lovely. All right. You guys played a drinking game with all my all rights today? Some white card bases. We're going to put everything on foam adhesive. So here's our big mama roll. We might be done with everything within the hour. That's kind of fast. I always do all four sides and then, you know, about three in the middle. I also like to put watercolor panels like this on foam tape, because if there's any warping, like these have just a little bit of warping. If there's any warping, the foam tape sort of pulls it down and flattens things out. All right, I need more foam tape. All right, and then we can go right here. And right here, I'm not gonna bother doing the foam like right there. Well, maybe I would. I've got this little itty bitty left. I might as well, right? Cut that in half. That one's barely too long. There we go. Perfect. All right. Now we can assemble everything. Oh, I love that. So cute. I love little cards like this to send out. I haven't sent out any cards in a little while, and I need to. I've got wedding thank yous to send. Any of my friends who have sent me wedding gifts, I'm just letting you know. Thank you cards are on the way. Don't they say you have like a long time to send thank yous for your wedding gifts? How long is it? It's not really a whole year, is it? I think like a few months is probably plenty. But then again, they say like people can send you wedding gifts for like up to a year after you get married. So that's kind of crazy. Okay. Oh, I love these. They're so cute. I love that. See the pink. There we go. Let me scoop my chair in here and then we can say hello and wrap up today's live. Okay, hello. Here I am. So, thank you guys so much for joining me today. Marcy says you have a year. Well, that's good. Thank you. That's good news. So colorful, looks like spring. Yes, I agree. We just need colorful things like this right now. We need the hope of spring. Let's see. Animal Crossing group. Yes, I really want to do it. I just haven't even had a chance. We had some like crazy house things happen with the new house, and all of our unpacking and everything was put on hold. Well, that was addressed and taken care of. Everything's good now. Everything's good. But it just really kind of slowed things down there for a minute. So anyway, yes, I'm hoping to get the Animal Crossing group going. Yeah, so watch for that sometime soon. Okay. La 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 la. Krista says, I was not sure about the top one, but now it's my favorite. Yeah, it's so different, right? Like once you have the images on there, it really changed things. I like that. Someone's asking about my shirt. I got it from J. Crew last summer. I don't think they have it anymore, but they do have some similar styles. I wouldn't be surprised if they come out with more that's similar this summer. Back is doing great. My back, someone asked about my back injury. My back has been doing so much better. Years ago when I had the same kind of back pain, it lasted for months and months because I was just trying to figure out how to cope with it, and like that it was caused by stress and then exacerbated by physical like strain. But I figured that out. It took months, but I figured it out, and now I already know how to handle it. So this time it really only lasted about a week, thank heavens. But yeah, feeling much better. Okay. Oh, Alicia, what is this about Animal Crossing? I play every day. I think it was a live maybe a month ago, maybe a little bit longer than that, I mentioned that I love Animal Crossing and that I wanted to put together an Animal Crossing group of just like card makers, and we can all help each other out. We can, you know, like if you've got a really high turnip price on your island, we can all come visit you. I think it was just last week I had a high turnip price. My price was $4.25. And so I posted on Facebook in a Facebook group and hosted a bunch of people coming to my island to sell their turnips. And I think I made almost $1 million in tips. So it was a lucrative offer. Someone's asking, what did you do to heal your back? Well, see, okay, so these are some things you can try, but it won't work for everyone because some people have a legitimate, like something physical going on in their back that causes their pain. Mine, years ago, I had three pinched nerves, I think. And so, but for the most part, I don't have any problem with those narrowing nerve areas, except for when the muscle, my piriformis muscles, like through my hips and glutes, if they are super tight. And if those muscles are really, really tight, then it kind of inflames and aggravates the entire area. And that really generally only happens when I'm super stressed or there's a lot going on. And it took me a while to figure out that it was like stress was the cause of that back pain. Like the stress would cause the back pain, and then I would like overcompensate to try to like reduce the pain, and then that would cause other things. It was like a domino effect. But unless I address the initial problem, which was the stress and the stressors in my life, it was not going to resolve itself. So basically I got married, sold my house, moved, didn't have a craft room. We had all this stuff happen at the house, which was stressful. There were workers and people coming in all the time. And especially with COVID and trying to be careful, it was just a lot. And I thought I was handling it so well. I was exercising, I was stretching, I was like trying to do all of those things that I know reduces my stress. But apparently that was not enough. I'm super extra when it comes to stress. I'm a very easygoing person in general. And I think I don't acknowledge the stress while it's happening. So I've had to learn to be like, oh yeah, all this is happening. Like this would really stress a person out. And then I'm like, okay, you're probably stressed. You should address the stress. So I started a book called Burnout, Ending the Stress Cycle, I think is what it's called. I have not finished it, but I've learned a lot from it and what are the major takeaways that I've, you know, just from the beginning of the book is that like anthropologically and biologically, there is a stress cycle. Like when we're in fight or flight, there is a point when the stress is gone and your body acknowledges that. And then you complete that stress cycle and you're good. However, with today's modern stressors and just different situations or things like if you were at an office every day and you have a coworker that stresses you out every single day, you don't ever get a break from that stressor. And so you never end the stress cycle. And if you have all these stress cycles that have never ended, it can build up in your body and it causes physical pain and ailments and things like that. And I really think that's what happens with me specifically, and I'm sure many other people. If I don't address the stress, it never goes away, even when the stressor is gone. So it's all about, yes, thank you. Chris is saying it's a fantastic book. It's called Burnout, The Secret to Unlocking the Stress Cycle by Emily Nagoski, PhD, and Amelia Nagoski. Yes, that is the book. You have to address both the stressors and the stress. And once you do that, then you can kind of break that cycle. And also it said something that really, like I was like, oh, totally makes sense. Was that one of the ways you can end the stress cycle is through exercise or physical activity. And so I was like, okay, my back is in pain. I don't want to move. I don't want to do anything, but I have to, because I have to tell my body that this stress is over and that I can move on. So I really forced myself, and it was interesting because it reminded me of a few years ago when I had this same stress problem and I had a lot of back issues because of it. That was when I got into water aerobics, and it was a very gentle exercise. And because of that, that's what started to like help my back. And I think it was because I was actually getting physical activity. And so now that I know that, I've learned from it years later, I was like, okay, I'm gonna force myself. I've gotta go work out. And once I forced myself to work out, like that was on a Monday, by like Thursday or Friday, I felt like 90% better. Like it was amazing for how much pain I was in before to just exercising for 4 or 5 days in a row, how much less pain I had at the end. That's not gonna work for everyone. Especially if you have like really extreme pain, pain that is beyond just like stress and some muscle fatigue and muscle strain. If you've really injured yourself or if there are other issues involved, by all means, don't go straight into exercise. I know myself, I kind of knew what this was, and so I knew what to do, but kind of crazy. Oh my word, crafts, gliders, and things said, ran my first 5K this week, 2 more for March. That is awesome. I can't wait to get back to running. I'm hoping I could do it soon. So, do I have a pool? No, I do not have a pool. It is way too cold here to justify having a pool, for me anyway. Okay. Oh, Tanya says, thank you for this information. I carry pain and stress. It is so true. Pain and stress go hand in hand, and one feeds off the other, and over and over and over. It's hard, seriously. But you know, crafting can be a stress relief, which is one of the best things we do, right? Oh, good. L. Kelly says, just order that book on Amazon and I'll get it today by 7. Perfect. We should just start a book club where we all read that book and then we discuss it and we figure out how we can reduce our stress. It would be great. Okay, well, I've been jabbering on and on for about 10 minutes, so we're going to close this up. Thank you so much for joining me. I'm going to do a special live next week, midweek in the evening, showing how to create that marker swatch chart. So watch for that. I will put up the regular scheduled thing on YouTube. You'll be able to see when that's going to go up, but probably Tuesday or Wednesday of next week. And hopefully I will be back on Monday with a video. I'm not entirely sure. I haven't had a chance to film anything now that I have my setup. Maybe I can film something and get creative. So I'm hoping, really hoping for a video on Monday, but we'll see. Thank you so much for tuning in and watching and contributing to the chat all about stress and pain. Hopefully we can all learn from each other. And you know, if we decide to do a book club where we all read this book, I would totally be on board. And my sister will probably come too because she loves that book. All right. Thank you guys so much for joining me today and for seeing me create my cards. Got to fill in this corner over here. I'm not sure what I'm going to store over there. Thank you so much for joining. I will see you guys in another video very soon.